Germany's refugee crisis. People are willing to help, but how is Europe going to deal with millions of refugees? How should they deal with them? We'll discuss that today with the Deputy National Chairman of the CDU and State Premier of Saxony, Stanislaw Tillich. Welcome.
Hello.
And welcome, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Thomas Spahn. Mr. Tillich, say we have a German village that has a population of 700, and they're asked to take in 300 refugees. Can you understand why some of the residents might be concerned about that?
There are various examples of places where people are wary. And there was a small area where there was resentment beforehand. But then, when the asylum seekers were there, in almost the same numbers as the local population, there was a sense of togetherness that continues to this day. So I don't think it's a question of numbers, but rather about how you prepare people for this, and of how people open up, become curious, and approach the new arrivals. And at the same time, it's about being curious and not prejudiced.
But if we know that there are also a certain number of right-wing radicals in a particular region, based on the number of NPD votes there in the last election, shouldn't we take a closer look at whether we should house foreigners there?
Well, the question is naturally, do we want to yield to right-wing extremists or stand up to them? And if we want to stand up to them, then in such a situation, you only need to take heed by taking special measures to protect the asylum seekers as well as the general population who are prepared to help them. But otherwise, I think that as a democracy, it's important, especially in such situations, not to back down. Certainly, it's also important to speak with people beforehand, people who were full of goodwill and good cheer, so that they're prepared. Then, ultimately, they can help.
Mr. Tillich, you were born in a small village. You still live in one. You belong to an ethnic minority group, the Sorbs, a Slavic people. Do you know from personal experience or from your family history what it's like to be treated as an outsider?
You know, even today you hear the old people telling what it was like to be driven out of the Sudetenland or Silesia in 1945. Often you'll still hear them described as refugees. So it's not just a phenomenon between minorities and majorities, but a phenomenon in the German-speaking world. As far as the Sorbs are concerned, we've been living together for over 1,000 years, but occasionally there is still friction, be it small or large. In recent months, there have been incidents where right-wing extremists have attacked young Sorbs, which clearly can't be tolerated. But at the same time, the Sorbs are self-confident and know how to defend themselves.
When you grow up as an ethnic minority, do you develop a greater understanding for other minorities like refugees?
Absolutely.
In what way?
You can imagine how those people must feel. And on the other hand, you also see what the majority is doing through other eyes. At the same time, you're also prepared, to a greater extent than most people realize, to do your part in promoting good relations.
You're a Sorb and also a Catholic. One of the primary obligations of Christianity is to show compassion for others. How upsetting is it for you that in this country even children are taken to demonstrations against the presence of refugees in their communities?
That's something that I can't even express in words, that there are people who, out of deep hate, uneasy feelings, and great animosity towards others, not only preach hate but also resort to violence. And then there are people who either stand alongside or applaud. Whether it's children or women with children, it's almost beside the point. It's not just stupidity. We need to tell them that what they're doing is just as bad. They're no different than those who not only preach hate, but exercise violence. They should know that. We've experienced this in recent days and weeks, and we've clearly stated that this goes beyond the limit of what is acceptable.
Some people obviously aren't listening. The chancellor was heckled last week when she visited a town in your state. Your reaction?
On the one hand, there's a right to freedom of speech. But on the other, I must clearly say it has nothing to do with dialogue and democracy when someone says that only his opinion counts and those of others don't matter. In the presence of the chancellor, as well as before her visit, I approached these people who were supposedly open to discussion. And I saw for myself how it was virtually impossible to utter a single sentence without being interrupted. We must recognize that there's a group who are so ideologically stubborn that I think conducting constructive dialogue with them is impossible. So it's necessary to isolate this group and make it publicly known that these are people who are not willing to contribute to our basic democratic values and who instead are willing to accept a rift in our society.
Your state is known as a center of scientific study. Your science minister now says that she's worried that these attacks on asylum seekers and refugees may prompt foreign students and scientists to stay away from Saxony. Do you share her concerns?
Of course, it's the natural consequence of what you were asking about earlier. The chancellor's visit and the incidents surrounding the refugee centers put Saxony in a bad light. They also harm the reputation of the many hardworking people who are open-minded and the many who are helping to care for refugees. Naturally, it's my wish that the minority who promote hate and violence don't get the upper hand. I don't want people to say, we won't visit anymore as tourists, or that scientists, employers, and employees avoid Saxony. I hope they'll say, we want to help strengthen the democracy there, to make it more powerful and pervasive.
Looking at the bigger picture, the fighting in Syria and Iraq has been going on for years. The Arab Spring movement has collapsed in many countries. In Africa, there's one crisis after another. Could we not have foreseen that all of these situations would have produced large numbers of refugees?
I still remember the wars in the Balkans. At the time, Europe needed the help of the Americans to end it. And in recent years, when it came to Syria and also North Africa, Europe has been virtually incapable of creating common foreign and security policies. And now we're experiencing the same thing regarding asylum policy, where there are major differences. So a few countries are carrying most of the burden, and that's something that must be corrected if Europe is supposed to function as anything more than a common market. There must also be a functioning security architecture and mutually agreed upon foreign and security policies.
Both the Chancellor and the Vice Chancellor have raised this issue, but how could we, for example, convince Great Britain to take in larger numbers of refugees relative to its population?
The British know that they're reliant on finding good, skilled professionals. But at the same time, they can't just cherry-pick. When there are such trouble spots, as there are around the world right now, then naturally they must play their part. And the same goes for everyone else. We need to engage in a much more intensive discussion than sometimes happens in 1 or 2 hour sessions at the Council of Europe.
Es ist manchmal in diesen ein- oder zweistündigen Ratssitzungen erfolgt.
We could just continue with what European politicians have been doing for years and say that when someone initially arrives in a country that's safe and moves on to another, that person can be sent back to the first safe country. The logic of that position is morally questionable, but it no longer works in any case. Is it not part of the problem that the refugees are moving from one country to the next?
We have two problems. Well, not really problems, but challenges. One is that we have people arriving from conflict areas, from the Arab world, from Syria, Iraq, and also from Africa. And then we have a second group of people who are making their way to Central Europe from the Western Balkans. And at the same time, the heads of government in these countries are saying they want to be considered a safe country of origin. So we need to find a common solution with these heads of government and the politicians there to ensure that these safe countries of origin ultimately also offer the security to allow these people to lead humane lives there. That means being able to work and develop. And that is, in and of itself, a piece of European policy. It's single market policy.
At the end of our interviews, we ask guests to complete three unfinished sentences. Please complete these sentences. To people who are not being persecuted, but who would like to come to Germany simply because they want a better life, I would say,
we need you, but there are other ways of applying for asylum status.
Many Germans have also been displaced from their homes, so I would ask the people of Saxony to show
humanity and simply a lot of heart.
Despite the massive refugee crisis, I remain hopeful that
many people will get involved and that they'll help prepare good homes for the people coming to us, even though there are so many.
Stanislav Tillich, thank you.
You're welcome.